Putting humans in the machine learning loop. I'm Tanya Hall, and joining me is Dr. Robert Monroe, author and CEO of Machine Learning Consulting. Welcome, Robert.
Thanks. It's great to be here.
Give us a brief summary of your background and tell us the type of business that you help at Machine Learning Consulting.
Yeah, so I've been working in machine learning for about 20 years. My career began as a software developer, working all around the world, from Australia originally, worked in Europe for a little while, and then I worked for the United Nations in West Africa, helping in refugee camps with post-conflict development. Since that time, I've really looked for ways where I can have a positive impact in the world through machine learning. So I first came to the US about 15 years ago to get my PhD at Stanford. My dissertation focused on ways that you can adapt machine learning to help with healthcare and disaster response, especially when people speak languages other than English and then French and Spanish, which are widely supported by your smart devices. And since then, I've worked in a mixture of startups and large companies. So I ran product for Amazon Web Services, first natural language processing and translation services. And I was CTO of the largest data labeling company. Right now, I run a consulting company, Machine Learning Consulting. And we help companies integrate machine learning into their products in ways where hopefully the customer doesn't even need to know that they're using machine learning. And our clients are really varied. So we're working with a very large manufacturer of agricultural equipment so that they can have better computer vision in their machines, working with a marketing company so that they can target enterprise advertising much more efficiently. And for the past couple of months, I've been doing personally a lot of work in the response to COVID. So using my background as professional disaster responder and advising the ways that different organizations can use machine learning to help with their response.
You're putting the finishing touches on your latest book, Human in the Loop, Machine Learning. What prompted you to write this book at this time?
So I wrote the book Human in the Loop, Machine Learning because it was the book I wish I had read when I began my data science career. A common thread in everything I've done in my career is that the data was more important than the algorithms in order to be accurate. That's super obvious in use cases like translation or information extraction or speech recognition. So obviously your smart device in your house or your phone, it can recognize when you speak in English, but it can't recognize 99% of the world's languages because it hasn't been trained on the data in those languages. Even for use cases where we do have data, more data can get you to higher accuracy really, really quickly. And so I wrote Human in the Loop Machine Learning because when you look at the computer science courses that I took and that I'm sure anyone else took, you learn a lot about the algorithm side of machine learning, but you don't learn much about what does the interaction with humans, what is that supposed to look like, and how can you create high quality training data to support whatever use case you're trying to build.
What are the weak links today in designing artificial intelligence?
So about 90% of AI systems which are deployed in the real world get smarter with human data. And so the biggest weaknesses that I've seen are access to quality data. I think as we're seeing good machine learning systems get more and more commoditized and much easier to use, some with open source systems or maybe sometimes with proprietary big cloud vendors, we're solving the algorithm side really, really well. But for a lot of these systems, they don't work unless you have hundreds of thousands of human manually labeled examples. So your smart device works because there have been hundreds of hours, probably thousands of hours of human speech, which has been manually transcribed. Translation works because there are millions of examples of sentences in two languages that a system can learn from. An autonomous vehicle can drive down the street and avoid the pedestrians because humans have spent thousands of hours identifying this is a pedestrian, this is a street sign, this is a cyclist in videos. And then the AI learns from that. And one of the reasons is that this is a big bottleneck is I like to say that most machine learning algorithms are a bunch of high school math just taped together in a really clever way. Like fundamentally, it's, you know, like logistic regression and you know, converging on a model with linear algebra. But again, like put together in smart ways. However, to implement good human quality control, to ensure that humans have the right labels to resolve disputes when humans disagree with each other when they're trying to annotate data, that requires college level math taped together in a really smart way. So I find when I'm employing data scientists, this is the biggest gap. It's not their algorithm knowledge. It's how to create a pipeline to get that human feedback as efficiently as possible.
When should you engage humans in fine-tuning machine learning, and how do you select the right people for those jobs?
So I think you need to think about a data strategy right at the start of your machine learning process. Your data strategy and your algorithm strategy should go hand in hand. And one of the toughest things is going to be deciding, well, who are the humans that are going to interact with the model that can create the training data, that can improve the accuracy. And there's a whole range of options. So you might have in-house experts, you might trust them to be very accurate on your data because of their domain expertise, but then they're gonna be a bottleneck. You only have so many experts in-house, their time is probably very valuable. And so you might not get the very large volumes of training data that you need. And so many companies look to outsourcing firms. So there are a number of very large and very successful companies that work only in annotating data for machine learning. In fact, there are more people employed to annotate data in outsourcing companies than there are employed to create algorithms within AI. It's actually the largest workforce in AI are people annotating the data. It's also a very international and very diverse workforce, but a very overlooked one. And then in addition to in-house experts or outsourced specialists in training data, there are crowdsourcing platforms as well, where you're basically employing gig economy workers. And for a dollar at a time, that they might, say, spend 20 cents annotating your data for you. And regardless of the workforce you choose, you're going to have to think about quality control. How do you identify when someone is given the wrong answer? How do you resolve disputes? How can you break up a complicated task into simpler ones to get better throughput and to get better accuracy?
We're off to a good start applying machine learning and AI to narrowly focused tasks. But what challenges do we face today in applying AI to broader, maybe less specific use cases?
Yeah, so I think one of the most interesting advances that I've seen recently in both the natural language processing and the computer vision fields are pre-trained models using techniques known as transfer learning. So an example of natural language processing would be very large models trained on very simple things like predicting the next word in a sentence or when two sentences follow each other. So tasks where the data is already there, you don't need humans to manually annotate it. And so you can build these models across very large amounts of data, so all of Wikipedia, or all open book text, other texts you have available to you, and then adapt them very easily to different tasks. So this kind of approach, which uses these existing models as embeddings or representations or as base models to tune, it currently gets state of the art across a really large number of different benchmarks. Say 10 years ago in natural language processing, it used to be the case you had one set of algorithms to do things like translation, another set of algorithms to do things like extracting information from text, another again to do filtering or identifying sentiment. Very different workflows, very different algorithms. Now you can start with one very general model built over all available data that you have for a language, and then with a smaller amount of human input, adapt that one model to every single one of these tasks. And what's really exciting about this is, well, for one, it's reducing the overall number of human annotations, amount of human input that you need to get to accuracy on these different tasks. And also it's given us a common framework. So it used to be the case that if you're a machine learning machine translation specialist, you probably didn't have a lot in common with an information retrieval specialist or a semantic analysis specialist. You use different algorithms, you have different jargon. Now everyone is using the same models and sharing a lot of their learnings across these different tasks. The only caveat I would say is that all it's done really, other than create a shared framework, is reduce the number of annotations. There aren't use cases yet where we're doing away with human engagement entirely, or that we're necessarily seeing models that can be more general with human engagement. So I think we're right at the start of those kind of advances.
Okay, Robert, how can people preview your book?
Yeah, so if you search for my book and your favorite search engine, Human in the Loop Machine Learning, you'll see that it's already up. My publisher is Menin. So if you go to menin.com and look for the book, you'll see it there as well. I believe there's free previews of the book already. I have 8 of the 12 chapters published online so far. You can publish the book you can purchase the book electronically and get the chapters as they're published, and also pre-order the print book as well.
Dr. Robert Monroe, CEO of Machine Learning and Consulting and author of Human in the Loop, Machine Learning. Thanks again, Robert, for joining us. And if somebody wants to connect with you personally, how can they do that?
Thanks, Tonya. If you'd like to connect with me, you're welcome to reach out to me directly on LinkedIn, or you can find me on Twitter at WWRob.
Thanks again. And find more of my interviews right here or at TonyaHall.net. Thanks for watching.